in fact that we should not confound what makes us happy to the state of happiness itself. We all might quite differ in what triggers this state, in what triggers our emotions. This depends on our culture we were brought up on, our personal history, our characters. But how we feel happiness is the same for all of us, and this is what I would like to talk about. How can we know that we all feel happiness in a very similar way? Let's look at this young man. He's from a people of Forer, living on the highlands of Papua New Guinea. And when his photo was shot by the American psychologist Paul Ekman in the late 1960s, his people, and in particular this man, never had any contact with any other culture, any other people from the outside world. And yet, you immediately understand how this man must be feeling. He's smiling, he's happy. And he will understand your smiles and your happiness. To show you that such research can indeed answer questions on which the jury has long been out, just think of the long-standing debate in philosophy whether happiness is just the absence of pain, or maybe more after all. Of course, translates in our everyday thinking. How often do we hope to be happy if we just could get rid of some unpleasant situation? Just think of all the lonely hearts who think life will be heaven after they finally found him or her. And then he or she really appears, and after a period of falling in love, I don't know. And this graph gives you one hint why it is so. Look at it. If happiness would really be just the opposite of unhappiness, you would expect them to look down like positive or negative of one another. But they really do not. They are just different. And many other findings from neuroscience show that happiness is really more than the absence of happiness. It is something different. It is something of its own. Of which the consequence, of course, is that to attain happiness, don't just wait for the pain to end, but rather you have to do something for it. Now, how is happiness being generated within our heads? In our heads, as you just saw, there are really networks for joy, lust, and euphoria. And we are equipped really with something that I once called a happiness system. And this is quite a new finding, and I am sure that this finding will affect our image of man in the 21st century at least as much as Freud's idea on the ever trouble-making unconsciousness were crucial for our image of man in the 20th century. We are born to be happy. And I would like to talk you through a brief walk through this happiness system. Lust, curiosity, and learning are really intrinsically intertwined. And without lust, there can be no learning. This truth is still by far not sufficiently being recognized by the way we run our schools, our universities, it's not recognized by the way our companies operate, and even not by the way we do social work. And this is why I would like to go very briefly a little deeper into it. Now, what does learning mean? Learning, and any learning, essentially corresponds to the creation of new connections in your brain between the neurons which you see here. dopamine, the so-called lust hormone, promotes precisely that. And this is why creativity and also analytical capacities is linked to positive and not to negative emotions. So the myth of unhappiness as a prerequisite for artistic achievements is just that. It's a myth. We now know that emotions, in particular those which we perceive consciously, promote such changes, of which the consequence is that we indeed can, to a certain extent of course, tune our brains into positive emotions. I think it is, first of all, it is important to realize that it is really possible to train our capabilities for happiness, just as we can train to speak a foreign language or to train to ride the bike. It doesn't come from today to tomorrow. It needs a training. And this is really where today's neuroscience meets with insights of certain Buddhist schools, but also of insight gained by the antique schools of philosophy of the store, for example. So, what can you do? Now, here are some advices of neuroscience. The first and I think most crucial point are cognitive strategies, that is, controlling your negative emotions. Mind you, I do not speak of suppressing negative emotions. I think negative emotions are important. They are signals. Signals want to tell us something, but once you have received the signal, fine, there you are. You know what's going on. You don't need to go into your anger or your sadness or your fear anymore. And such cognitive strategies have been shown to be by far the most effective psychological strategy to deal with even severe depression. You can go beyond that. You can reinforce your positive emotions by simply keeping track of them. And one strategy that has proven to be very efficient is just to write them down. Second, be active. Nature rewards us with happiness for activeness, not for just lazing out in the sun. Third, physical exercise and sex. Happiness is a very bodily feeling, and studies in social psychology shows that the contact of people with life is very strongly correlated with the amount of physical exercise that pursue, and of course the amount of sex and its quality, if you wish. Sharpen your perception. I talked about how the dopamine system directed our attention is related to euphoria, learning, but also attention. Be curious and see contrasts in life for the very same reason. And to, I think, no one's surprise, interpersonal relationships are very important. I would like to conclude with two philosophers. The first one from a Stoic school named Epicurus, of whom Alan talked this morning. We should bestow great care on happiness, because we have everything when it's present and do everything to achieve it when it lacks. And Baruch Spinoza, a Dutch philosopher of the Enlightenment, already was quite aware how much happiness is linked to our cognitive and creative performance, saying joy is a transition of mind into a state of perfection. Thank you very much.